Okay, so an RBM can extract features and reconstruct inputs. But how exactly does that help with the vanishing gradient? By combining RBMs together and introducing a clever training method, we obtain a powerful new model that finally solves our problem. Let's now take a look at a deep belief network. Just like the RBM, deep belief nets were also conceived by Geoff Hinton as an alternative to backpropagation. Because of his accomplishments, he was hired for image recognition work at Google, where a large-scale DBN project is currently believed to be in development. In terms of network structure, a DBN is identical to an MLP, but when it comes to training, they are entirely different. In fact, the difference in training methods is the key factor that enables DBNs to outperform their shallow counterparts. A deep belief network can be viewed as a stack of RBMs, where the hidden layer of one RBM is the visible layer of the one above it. A DBN is trained as follows. The first RBM is trained to reconstruct its input as accurately as possible. The hidden layer of the first RBM is treated as the visible layer for the second, and the second RBM is trained using the outputs from the first RBM. This process is repeated until every layer in the network is trained. An important note about a DBN is that each RBM layer learns the entire input. In other kinds of models, like convolutional nets, early layers detect simple patterns and later layers recombine them. Like in our facial recognition example, the early layers would detect edges in the image, and later layers would use those results to form facial features. A DBN, on the other hand, works globally by fine-tuning the entire input in succession as the model slowly improves, kind of like a camera lens slowly focusing a picture. The reason that a DBN works so well is highly technical, but it would suffice to say that a stack of RBMs will outperform a single unit, just like a multilayer perceptron was able to outperform a single perceptron working alone. After this initial training, the RBMs have created a model that can detect inherent patterns in the data, but we still don't know exactly what the patterns are called. To finish training, we need to introduce labels to the patterns and fine-tune the net with supervised learning. To do this, you need a very small set of labeled samples so that the features and patterns can be associated with a name. The weights and biases are altered slightly, resulting in a small change in the net's perception of the patterns, and often a small increase in the total accuracy. Fortunately, the set of labeled data can be small relative to the original data set, which, as we've discussed, is extremely helpful in real-world applications. Have you ever trained a deep belief network before? If so, please comment and share your experiences. So, let's recap the benefits of a deep belief network. We saw that a DBN only needs a small labeled data set, which is important for real-world applications. The training process can also be completed in a reasonable amount of time through the use of GPUs. And best of all, the resulting net will be very accurate compared to a shallow net, so we can finally see that a DBN is a solution to the vanishing gradient problem. Now that we've covered the deep belief net, we can begin to discuss a few other deep learning models and see what kinds of problems they can solve. Let's jump over to the next video and take a look at how a convolutional net could be trained to recognize different objects in an image.